So we're going to start off today's message with a little bit of fun. It's going to require some participation from all of you wherever you are. We're going to do our own version of the game show that you've maybe seen before called Don't Forget the Lyrics. Anyone know it? Yeah, Don't Forget the Lyrics. You're getting nervous, I can see, and you should be. Don't Forget the Lyrics, simple game show. They have people kind of sing along with the song, then they abruptly stop the song. And the goal is you keep singing, you sing the next line to see if you know the lyrics to the song. That's what we're going to do. Now, I'll just give you this. If you were a teenager or a young adult in the early 80s, you are a shoo-in on this song. This one should be easy for you. Although, if you're not, this is a pretty well-known song. So that's what we're going to do. We're going to see some lyrics to the first part of it. I'm going to invite you to sing along, be participatory. Then when the music stops, if you know the next line, sing it out, okay? Here we go. Here's the song. Oh, yeah, that's a good one, isn't it? I see lots of you in the demographic section who should know this song, so. All right, here we go. We need, like, a karaoke count in.
Every breath you take.
Sing along. I'll join you in a second.
Every move you make. Every bond you break. Every step.
All right, who said I'll be watching you? All right, you got it right. Good job. All of you get prizes. The prize is my appreciation. All right, so that one was easy. We started easy. This one's going to be a little trickier. Same song, next part. Let's do it.
Every single day, and every word you say.
Who said something about breaking, vows breaking? Anyone say that? That's not it. Every breath you take, that's not it. Anyone think they know what it was? Every step you take, that's not it. Oh, I think I heard it. Oh, no, that's not it. I thought I heard it. Someone else heard it. No one? Every bond you break, no, that's later in the song. And it's a tricky song. Every night you stay. Did someone say that? Okay, well, that's the right answer. Every night you stay, I'll be watching you. Now, we could go on and do that all day because I love that song. Anyone else? It's a great song. 1983, The Police, Every Breath You Take, also known as the Stalker song. If you're unfamiliar with that song, you start to listen to it, you're like, what is going on? And he's talking about his ex-girlfriend and how she's broken his heart, and now he's watching everything she does, and it's kind of creepy. But I guess in 1983, we weren't big on restraining orders yet, so we didn't know that was illegal. The reason I bring this up, the Stalker song, is because today, I don't know if you know this, there is a Stalker song, a Stalker psalm in the Bible. Did you know that? One that's almost as unnerving as that song from 1983, Psalm 139. And because the Psalms are songs, these are just lyrics, I'm going to read this to you, and I'm not going to teach you about it. I just want you to take it in as you would song lyrics. Psalm 139. O Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit? Where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. If I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me and your right hand shall hold me. If I say, surely the darkness shall cover me and the light about me be night, even the darkness is not dark to you. The night is bright as the day, for darkness is as light with you. You formed my inward parts. You knitted me together in my mother's womb. I praise you, for I am fearfully and wonderfully made. Wonderful are all of your works. My soul knows it very well. My frame was not hidden from you when I was being made in secret, intricately woven in the depths of the earth. Your eyes saw my unformed substance. In your book were written, every one of them, the days that were formed for me, when as yet there was none of them. How precious to me are your thoughts, O God. How vast is the sum of them. If I could count them, they are more than the sand. I awake and I am still with you. Oh, that you would slay the wicked, O God. O men of blood, depart from me. They speak against you with malice, with malicious intent. Your enemies take your name in vain. Do I not hate those who hate you, O Lord? And do I not loathe those who rise up against you? I hate them with complete hatred. I count them my enemies. Search me, O God, and know my heart. Try me and know my thoughts. And see if there be any grievous way in me, and lead me in the way everlasting. As you hear those words, maybe you feel comfort, or maybe you feel a little uncomfortable. This God that you cannot escape from, you can't flee from him. No matter where you go, he is there. He's watching you everywhere you go. I don't know about you. I don't know if that gives you comfort or if that makes you feel uneasy. Or maybe there's a combination of both that you feel when you hear those words. It's clear that David, the one who wrote this song, it's clear to me that he doesn't see this as something that's unnerving. It's something that he sees as a comfort. And the question I want to ask is why? Why is that? Well, that's because really there are two ways to know about a person. The first way is through cold surveillance. You can watch someone from afar. You can stake out in front of their house. You can tap their phones. You can look at their browser history. You can stalk them. You can set up a police surveillance state. This is our concern about big data, right? Google and Meta and all these companies. We're like, what do they know about us? They're watching us. This is why, you know, some of us dump Google and we use browsers that don't accept cookies. When we don't accept cookies into our, if you don't know what I'm talking about, it's probably for better because it's all crazy stuff to know how much you're being watched. This is what unnerves us. This is a way people can get to know you, but it's through cold surveillance, through watching from a distance. That's one way you can get to know about a person. And it happens all the time. But there's another way you can get to know about a person. I'm going to call this the 50 years of marriage way, where you can know everything about a person. You can finish another person's sentences. Where you know exactly what another person is feeling, not because you're a mind reader, but because you've gotten that skilled at reading their body language, their nonverbals. Where you know their hopes and dreams, again, not because you're reading their diary, but because you've lived their hopes and dreams, you've created them together, where you know their pain, because you've lived through their pain. You've sat with them in their pain. I met Jocelyn, my wife, when I was 19 years old. We've been together since I was 20. So 25 years together, and there are so many things that are imperfect about our marriage, and even as my kids get older, there's some things about, you know, getting married young that I think are probably dicey about getting married young, but here's one thing I can really appreciate, and it's a great gift in our marriage. that after being together 25 years, no one knows me like Jocelyn does, which at times can be unnerving. She's got all kinds of stuff to use against me in an argument. And she knows when I'm bluffing. She knows when I'm not being honest about something. She knows me that well. It can be unnerving, but for most of the time, it's a gift. It's a gift to be known. Her deep knowledge of me is comforting. She's been watching me, yes. For 25 years, she's been watching me. But it's a kind that actually opens up my heart. See, I want to ask you today, when you think about God, a God who knows everything about you, a God you cannot escape from, the God of Psalm 139, who you cannot flee, who knows the words of your mouth before you speak one, who knew all of your days before one came to pass, when you think about a God who knows you in that way, which type of knowing comes to mind for you? See, I think often we lean on the first. We're like, well, God is all-knowing, he's omniscient, he knows everything about everyone all the time, so he knows everything. He's got all of the intel, all of the data, he gets the briefings, he knows everything about me. I think we tend to lean on this first one, but this is not the reason David wrote Psalm 139. This was not his inspiration for the psalm, if you couldn't tell. See, David's inspiration is realizing that God has been studying him, not as a stalker studies someone, but as a parent studies their baby. If you ever had a young child, or if you have one now, and they're sleeping in your arms, you know this drill. You have nothing to do but hold them, but you find yourself just studying all of their features. And the way they breathe, the way their chest moves, the way their lips might like curl or suck, or the way their mouth is formed. You study every feature and you delight in them. See, David knows that God has been studying him in that way. Because after all, God is the God who knit him together. God is the God who designed him, David says. God knows him so well because he dreamed David up. And then he created him. He knows every part intricately because he assembled him. David realizes that God knows him because they've been through everything together, all of life together. There's never been a journey David has gone on where God has not been his companion. See, it's a different kind of knowing. The first kind of knowing that makes us maybe want to run or hide or conceal or get off the grid. Get rid of our Ring doorbell because who knows who's getting that data, right? The second kind of knowing, that's the kind of knowing that makes us want to draw closer. It's the kind of knowing that inspires poetry and love songs like Psalm 139. It is the faith reaction. It moves us to love and trust. And perhaps if you find God's knowledge of you, his deep knowledge of you, his awareness of everything about you, if you find that threatening, if that feels overwhelming, if that feels kind of creepy to you, it's because you're thinking of the wrong kind of knowledge. You don't understand the way that he knows you. So that first kind of knowledge, again, that's scary. That second kind of knowledge is what we all long for. Whether our marriages give us that or not, that's what we want. We want to be known in that way. And the psalm today reminds you that you are known in exactly that way. See, if this was true for David, if David understood that, how much more should we understand that? Because David hadn't even seen the coming of Jesus yet, but we, being witnesses of the coming of Jesus, we saw what God did, a God who already knows everything. He's got all the knowledge, all the power, and yet what did he choose to do? He chose to come down and be like us, to live among us, to get to know us from the inside out. Of course, he already knew all that, but yet what does he do? He chooses that second kind of knowing. He came, the Bible says, to wed himself to us, to live life with us. As a bride and groom live out life together, who could imagine a Savior so empathetic? Not just knowing in a cold way, but wanting to really know. Who could imagine a Savior a God with such great love. Most of us imagine God as a God who has all of this information and he uses it to come and inspect us and judge us and shame us and expose us, but that is not his way. Jesus is his way. God himself has opted for that second kind of knowing. So here's the problem, though, with all of that, and all that's absolutely true. Take it, receive it, believe it. But here's a problem. If all that's true, then how do we explain the bad stuff? This God who wants to know us, who's come near us, who's come close, who doesn't want to stay far off, who sees us everywhere we go, who's with us on every part of our journey, how do we explain the bad stuff? And not only that, what do we mean when we say that God is behind us? Probably a couple of years ago, someone passed along this book to me. It's a book written by Sandy Brown. For those of you who are local here in St. Louis, she's on Joy FM, the Christian radio station, one of the morning crew, and then she's the founder and the president of Joy FM. It's a book that she wrote with her therapist. It's called Healing Out Loud, How to Embrace God's Love When You Don't Like Yourself. And someone passed this book on to me, And they put a note, and on the note they said, Pastor Dion, this is a book that is primarily written for women, but I think you'd really like it. And I've been trying really hard not to read into that statement too much. But I did read it, and they were right. I really do like it. It's a book about a woman of great faith who knows about God's love, has lived under God's love, has helped other people find God's love, and yet the reality was, she discovers that she just doesn't like herself. She feels bad inside all of the time in spite of God's great love for her. So it's a pretty solid book. And as she's talking through her story, she works with a therapist, Christian therapist, for the first time in her life. And she starts to realize some of these things that have made her not like herself in spite of the great love of God. And she talks about a couple things. I'm not going to get into all of them. But one of the things that she encounters as a young child is this moment where her dad abandons her and the family in a really heartbreaking way. Tries to take her brother along, but doesn't even want to take her. It's like, no, I don't want her, and then leaves and never comes back. And so she's working through this moment. She's going back with her therapist to this moment to really try to understand the hurt that was there, the lies that were sown in her mind there. And I want to read you this excerpt from the book. She says, while I was processing the memory of my dad leaving, Michelle, my therapist, also asked, so where was God? I'd never even thought about that before. But as we discussed the memory and prayed for clarity, I felt like God opened my eyes to something I hadn't previously seen or considered. I saw 5-year-old me scrunched behind the chair, afraid and crying. But I saw that God was there too, his presence with me. I hadn't been aware of him back then, but it was so clear now. God wasn't up there somewhere keeping a comfortable distance. He was close. He was with me. It felt like he knew I needed him, so he wanted to be there. It didn't matter if I realized it or not. He was still there attending to me, one of the least of these. I can't explain how powerful an image it was to see God moving in close to my fearful, broken heart. He hadn't left me. He chose to be near me. He wanted to be close to me. The lie had been told to me that I was unwanted and alone. The truth was almost too powerful to fathom. The God of the universe had come close to me that night. It brought a great deal of comfort and clarity. If God was with me then, he is with me now. I find that really beautiful. If you're someone who has things behind you in your story that are really, really painful and you feel abandoned and alone, I love this reminder that we can go back to those moments and we can see them differently through the eyes of faith, through the teaching of Psalm 139, that God was there. He's been present in every moment of your life and he didn't abandon you in your hardest moments. I think that's beautiful. I think that's transformative. It's healing. Sandy Brown talks about that in her book. But when I talk about God being a God who is behind you, I go even further than that. I mean something even stranger when I say that. Yes, I mean that in your hardest moments, in your timeline, I do believe that God was there, but it goes further than that. Here's what I've come to believe. Not only was God there in your hardest moments, even if you didn't see him, he was there. He never abandoned you. He was there. Here's what I've come to believe, that maybe, yes, God was there then, but maybe God has never left that moment. Maybe God is still there with terrified 5-year-old you crying behind the chair. This is going to be weird for some of you, and if it is, that's okay. You can let this part go. I think I gave you enough to count as a good sermon, and you can go home and have a good day. This is really important. Again, if you can't grab onto it, maybe it's just that you haven't lived through this stuff yet, or maybe it's okay. But let me share this with those of you who are going to receive something from this. We are coming to learn, especially through the study of serious PTSD, post-traumatic stress disorder. You've heard of that, PTSD. We've come to learn how, although we're mortal people, we're not time travelers, at least I don't think any of you are from the future. We've come to learn that in an instant, with a sound, with a smell, with a sight of something, we can be transported. We can find ourselves back in a moment in our timeline, someplace behind us. We can be transported to a moment in our past. We can't technically travel there, but in a real way, we can and we do. And even those of us who maybe don't have PTSD, we've all experienced that, right? How just in a moment we can be transported back to some moment in our past. Maybe a painful moment, maybe a good moment. Maybe there's a smell of something baking and it reminds you of your grandmother's house and you feel all the warmth and the joy and the safety and the love. You've experienced that, right? How, although you're here and you're bound into this moment in time, yet in a very real way you can find yourself in a moment transported to another moment in your timeline. If that's true for us, mere mortal beings, not time travelers, how much truer is it for God? A God who can find us wherever we are, the highest heights, the lowest depths. How much truer is it for a God who is eternal? Eternity, by the way, does not mean forever as much as it means always, always. Eternity doesn't take forever. Eternity doesn't last forever in the way that we think of it. Eternity, and this is why some of us are terrified of heaven, that eternity is not day after 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 day, right? I mean, you couldn't even handle me saying that 20 times. Like, imagine living that forever. Eternity is outside of all of time. It's outside of all time. It's being free from timelines. See, and if that's who God is, to borrow a phrase from a recent movie, if God is everything, everywhere, all at once, and here's what I've come to believe, that not only do I believe that God was with me in my hardest moments, the darkest moments of my past, I believe that he's still there. That although I flash back and forth between the present moment and those moments, and I get pulled back into those moments, here's what I believe. A God who never leaves me, will never abandon me, is still there attending me. 5-year-old me, 15-year-old me, 45-year-old me, as I'm facing the hardest things I've ever faced, the things that haunt me at night, that give me cold sweats in my dream, the things that with a sight, a sound, I'm transported and I'm completely unaware of my surroundings because I'm back living through something really, really hard. Those horrible moments, I believe that God has never left me in those moments. That a God who transcends our timeline, he is also still there with me. As much as I feel stuck in those moments, God has chosen to stay stuck with me in those moments. He refuses to leave me, and he will remain there with me until his healing work is done. That's strange. It's weird, I know. But I think I'm actually in good company on this. Pastor and theologian Tim Keller, he wrote a book called The Reason for God. It's a great book. If you've never read it, I encourage you to read it. It's a very logical, deep, but orthodox way of thinking about who God is and why it makes sense to believe in God. In this book, Keller explores in one chapter the suffering and death of Jesus, and he asks an interesting question. He says, so why is it that Jesus, who suffered greatly, he was tortured, he was beaten, he was crucified, an awful way to die. Why is it that Jesus takes that so much worse than so many other martyrs of the faith who have died throughout time? People who have been drawn and quartered, people who have been burned at the stake, people who have just been like, there are countless stories of people dying in gruesome ways for their faith. And in many of those stories, these people die with smiles on their faces, singing psalms and hymns of praise. So Keller asked the question, so why is Jesus, the Son of God, why does he take it so hard? Why does he cry out in anguish? Why does he sweat blood when so many other people have faced at least as hard, as difficult of things and done it better? And then he begins to explore and he says, The reason is that when we think about Jesus dying and suffering, it wasn't just 3 hours of suffering followed by a death, but Keller says, when Jesus was facing suffering and death as an eternal being, he was facing an eternal death, an ongoing death. It means his suffering is never over. He suffered like no one has ever suffered because his suffering is limitless. It's outside of time. It's unending. Jesus is still suffering for you, for our sins. He's suffering for our brokenness. He's suffering for our alienation. He's suffering in an ongoing way. And in those moments, we catch a glimpse of the anguish that he's receiving in himself out of love for you and me. And if that's heavy, you can also know this, that in the same way then, the joy of Easter, the joy of resurrection, that is also eternal and ongoing, and it's never over. Jesus is living and suffering in joy, and those things are radiating out from him to us. See, this is why this matters. If I can trust that God is behind me, not only in my painful moments where I've been hurt, but in those moments where I was the one doing the hurting, I was the one causing pain. If God is in my most shameful moments, my most regrettable moments, if God is behind me still in all of those pivotal, seminal moments, if he is still there, if he's always there, if he's right at the epicenter of those things, then here's what that means for me. Not only was he there and he didn't abandon me, and that's good, what that means for me is if he's still there holding space at the epicenter of that event, that means that all of the shockwaves, all of the ripple effects of those hard things, those bad things, those dark things, those evil things, those ripple effects that were sent to harm me, destroy me, crush me, break me, that caused pain for me and pain for others, as long as Jesus is there, here's what this means. That as long as he's there, he's changing the very nature of the earthquake. If he's at the epicenter, then this is what this means. Wave after wave, he's transforming those waves, those shock waves of pain and destruction. He's changing them into waves of formation and redemption and healing and love. Even when I'm not back there, he's still back there doing the work. We say all the time that with time, things will change. That's not how time works. With time, painful things don't become less painful. That's not true. With time, time only ravages. Time leaves things worse. If you don't believe me and you're over the age of 40s, look in the photo album from 5 years ago till now, or look what happens to your house after that remodel that you did of your kitchen 10 years ago. Look at it now, right? Time leaves things worse. You can believe that with time, these things will naturally change and the pain will become less and the destruction will become less. I don't think that's true. See, it's not with time that these things change. It's with God that these things change. A God who is not only with us in that moment, helping us move through it, but a God who is still there, changing the very meaning and the nature of that event, changing the ripple effects from being waves of destruction to waves of healing. See, God is behind you. That means he has never left that painful moment. He is redeeming it in all ways, for always. So whatever that thing is in your life, here's what I want you to know. He is behind you. And he is sorting it all out. That thing that you can't even sort out anymore. That thing you can't make sense of. That thing that it's just too tangled up. It's too messy. He's there still at the center of it, sorting it out for you. And this means, because he's behind you, that he's healing all the things that you just want to leave behind. In your mind, the best case is I can just leave that behind. I can close the door on that chapter. I can lock that stuff away, and I can move ahead. He loves you too much to waste that stuff, to let that stuff be wasted, to let it remain to be evil, to let the ripple effects and the waves be destructive. He loves you too much to let you leave it behind. So here's what he's doing instead. Leave this to my core, that he's still there redeeming it. He's changing it until it's completely healed. Until the nature of that thing becomes something that doesn't bring destruction and pain. It brings life and formation and joy. Now, if you're confused or overwhelmed, good. Because now maybe you're able to understand the mind of David as he wrote that song we looked at earlier. Oh Lord, you have searched me and known me. You know when I sit down and when I rise up. You discern my thoughts from afar. You search out my path and my lying down and are acquainted with all my ways. Even before a word is on my tongue, behold, O Lord, you know it altogether. You hem me in behind and before, and you lay your hand upon me. Such knowledge is too wonderful for me. It is too high. I cannot attain it. Where shall I go from your spirit, or where shall I flee from your presence? If I ascend to heaven, you are there. And if I make my bed in Sheol, you are there. If I take the wings of the morning and dwell in the uttermost parts of the sea, even there your hand shall lead me, and your right hand shall hold me. We pray. God in heaven, give us the ability, even though these things are too wonderful, too lofty for us to attain, give us the ability today to just enlarge our faith, enlarge in our faith for us, God. That as we think about your presence with us, we don't just think about where we can go in terms of space, location, but God, we also think about those moments when we're traveling back in time, when we're going back to places behind us, places that seem so dark and forsaken and painful, and we just feel like they're universally bad and awful, and we want to close the door and we want that stuff to go away. God, enlarge in our faith today, first, to recognize that you were there, that we've never been abandoned once. God, give us the eyes to see in those moments that we go back to that you were present by faith, by your spirit. Help us see you there with us so that we can know that we are not alone, that we are never abandoned, that you are a God who always stays close. But God, also enlarge in our faith to invite you in to those places that are behind us, to believe, to trust, to see that you are always at work in those hurtful places. God, that even there, your right hand of grace and favor is holding us, and that you, the God of all power and might, the God of all goodness, the God of redemption, that you are redeeming even now the darkest, hardest things that we've ever been through. And that as long as we're stuck, as long as we're in need of healing, you will stay there doing the work on our behalf in love for us. God, help us recognize your presence with us in every part of our story. But God, also give us the faith to invite you in so that we know we're not alone, and that the worst things that ever happened to us don't get the final word, that you get the final word, God. Give us the faith to invite you in to keep doing your redeeming, healing work until all the healing is completed. We pray it in your eternal name, Jesus. Amen.
Thank you for joining us and being a part of our online Pathfinder community. If you're new, you can find helpful links to resources in the description below or at pathfinderstl.org. While you're there, you can also find our message podcasts, which allow you to listen to the weekend message on the go. If you're out jogging, driving a car, whatever you do, you'll never miss out on a message. If this service was a blessing to you, spread the news and bless others. Hit that subscribe button, like, and comment. Do your part in spreading the life-changing message of Jesus by sharing this video with others. Blessings to you this week. We'll see you next time.